Have you always wanted to unlock the secret to pissing everyone off on the internet? Do we have a video for you today? Getting everyone triggered on the internet is a lot easier than you may think. And in today's video, we're going to give you the secret. But in the meantime, I'm going to go ahead and wire up this amplifier in the back of my Jeep so that we can have some slaps. About that little guy. All right, guys, so all joking aside, I hope you found that skit a little bit funny, but I've noticed, you know, in my time on YouTube, which has been, God, probably 7 years now, the easiest way to piss people off on the internet is to weld something, wire something, or have an opinion that nobody agrees with. And even if people do agree with it, they'll disagree with it just to have a different opinion so that they can argue on the internet. It's a very interesting thing. And in 2023, I don't care. You know what? People are going to argue. People are going to get mad. People are going to do whatever. But do what you like. Don't try to follow the crowd. That's the key. So what we're going to be doing today is 2023. I figured, you know what? I'm going to take you guys along on the journey for the things that I do when you guys aren't watching. So you guys have seen all the Jeeps and the welding videos and the welder reviews and the, you know, the car diagnostics and troubleshooting and all that other stuff. But I've never actually made a video where I showcase the things that I like to do outside of the crazy work environment. And a lot of that has to do with, you know, being what some are going to say is ridiculous, but an audiophile. I like my audio. I like car audio. I like home audio. I like pro audio. There's a bunch of stuff that I've gotten into audio-wise that I love doing. And today we're going to be taking my Grand Cherokee here, and we're going to be taking the Zapco amp out of it that I have in there that I put in temporarily, and we've got some new down for sound stuff that we're going to throw in. So I figured I'd take you guys along on that journey because we're going to be doing a budget install of this stuff. And by budget, I don't necessarily mean inexpensive. I mean, I put myself on a budget for this particular vehicle, and we'll go through what all this stuff costs towards the end of it. But I wanted to make something that I'm going to enjoy and that will sound good, you know, to my ears. And again, with audio, it's all subjective. What one person considers sound quality might not be. What one person considers bass might not be. But I'm going to try to put everything together in a package that hopefully you'll be able to understand. And what I think what we're going to do with this one is we're actually going to run a series. And that series is going to be educational for the most part. I see a lot of stereo systems that are done incorrectly, and they're dangerous. Not that they're done with poor taste or what have you, because that's out there too, but they're done in a way that's very dangerous. They're done in a way that's very not cost effective because it causes things to explode and blow up and burn amps and burn speakers and all that other stuff. So we're going to go through an entire process with this. Today we're going to do the install, and then as we go on in this video series, we're going to do the install, then we're going to go over properly wiring things, properly setting up your gains, you know, tuning your system to make it sound good, the pros and cons of using stock speakers in these newer vehicles versus using stock speakers in an older vehicle. There's a wealth of information out there that I can give you guys on doing car audio with some of these newer cars. And there's also a wealth of equipment out there from budget to holy crap, that's expensive. So today what we're going to be doing is I've got these set of subs that I've had for years. And they are Sundown Audio SA8 V2s. They're not an inexpensive subwoofer by any means. I think, you know, just off the top of my head, I think these were $375 a piece, something like that. But they can handle 650 watts RMS per speaker. They're a dual 4-ohm voice coil, dual voice coil. They're massive. And I built this box custom probably 10 years ago for these subwoofers. It is a ported box tuned at roughly 34 hertz, and it is all nice and curved on the inside. You can't see that because it's all together. And then what we did is I had put my Zapco 2000 watt amp in here, my Class D amp. Now the Zapco stuff belongs in my BMW. I just put it in here so I could have some sort of sound or noise, and we're going to remove that today. And we're going with a couple of down for sound amps. Now I have the JP34 and you guys have a tether in your face. I have the JP34AB, which is a Class AB amp, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And then below it, I have the JP23, which is a Class D subamp. The JP34AB is roughly about 150 watts of channel by 4. And the JP23 is a 2300 watt amp that on dyno tests has made close to 4,000. So pretty significant amplifiers. Very inexpensive too. Very budget friendly if you're looking for inexpensive. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to mount those. We're going to wire them. I have a Zapco DSP that we're going to be using in this build because I don't want to put it back in the BMW because I'm going to go a different route with that car. So we're going to have the DSP, the two amplifiers. We've got a Kenwood double DIN head unit already sitting in there. And we're going to do some wiring. We're going to do some amplifiering and hopefully no fires. And then, you know, if we're good at what we're doing here, we're going to anger the entire internet. So stay tuned. Okay, so one of the first things that we needed to do is we needed to locate the factory amplifier. Being that this car came with the Boston Acoustic system in it, with navigation and everything, there's an amplifier. Luckily for us, we're putting our amplifiers, our new ones, back here in the back of the vehicle, and the amp happens to be in the back of the vehicle. So now where this install is going to get a little funny is that right now this amplifier controls two speakers in the dash, two mid-bass drivers in the front doors, and two 5 1/4 inch drivers in the rear doors. Now, we only have four channels of amplification. That four channel amplifier I'm going to use to provide power to the front stage, meaning the 3 1/2 inch drivers in the dash and the 6x9 mid bass drivers in the doors. Now, I've already swapped out the mid bass drivers in the doors because they were shot from the factory and I had to put a set of doors on this car. One of them was an Infinity speaker, one was a Boston Acoustic speaker. So I just replaced them with a set of Pioneer 6x9s. Luckily for me, they're three-way 6x9s with internal crossovers. So I'll be able to get more of a full range out of those door speakers by amplifying them than I can with the factory amplifier, because the factory amplifier has a crossover that basically only allows mid-bass tones to come out of those door speakers. So we've got an advantage here. Now the other thing that we're doing too is to retain our rear door speakers. We're going to leave the head unit connected to this factory amplifier. This factory amplifier will then power the rear speakers only. It will power the rear door speakers and we'll have full control over that with the fader on the head unit because of the way that we're setting everything up. The reason we needed to get to this amp in the first place is we have to locate and extend all of the wiring for the two speakers in the dash and the two speakers in the front doors. So luckily, Google is amazing with stuff like that. I've Googled a pinout for these, and now that we know the pinout, we can pull this plug and that plug, and we can get our speakers. We can extend it with some wiring that I bought, and then we can wire them to the amp. So let me show you guys a bit of what we're thinking about here. So one of the things about these vehicles that's kind of interesting, especially these WK Grand Cherokees, is that there's a nice little spot right here that you might think, oh, that'd be perfect for amplifier location because it lifts up, there's a cubby underneath it. But the problem with that is we're using, and I apologize for the weird light, I'll take that away. So we're using Class AB amp and a Class D amp. Class D amps tend to stay very cool, Class AB amps, not so much. They run very, very hot. So we are going to mount them to the back seat. And the reason I'm mounting them to the back seat is one, I don't want them in harm's way, and two, with the back seat, you'll see the amps, they're kind of cool looking, so we want to mount them to the back seat. So what we need to do now is we need to take the wires from that amplifier, and we need to get them extended and over to the back seat area. So I bought 100 feet of wire. I'm going to take that wire, cut it up in four pieces so that we have 25 feet each, splice it into the proper wiring over here, and then we'll be good to go. Okay, tip number 357 on how to piss off the internet. Butt connectors. So we got all of our line here, and I cut each one of them to about 17 and a half feet so that we can follow the factory harness, make it all look super nice and everything else. And then we just butt connected it to all the connector or all the wires from the amp. Now, when we chopped the wires off the factory amp, I left tails on each one of these. So each one of these has a tail that's long enough so if we want to reconnect it to the factory amp, like if we're selling this vehicle or something, we can go ahead and do that. So each one of them has a tail. Now, the only thing we have left to do with these wires right here is we got to label each one of them. Front left, front right, door left, door right, so that we can actually hook them up to our amplifier. So I'm going to go ahead and label these. We'll get them all tucked in and run them to about where they need to be. Alrighty, so now you can see, because of the way that it is, all of the wiring that we just ran follows the factory harness all the way down. And the reason that you want to do that, it does make it difficult to change it if we need to change it, but running in the factory harness location, we know that when we put this whole plastic piece here back in, we are not going to crimp any wires or pinch any wires or anything because we're running in the factory harness location. So we'll be good. Now, I don't know if you guys can see it, but while we were in there too, I went ahead and ran. So you see the hook right there. That hook is what holds the seats back. That is bolted into a very strong place on the body. So we went with a 1/0 right to that bolt. And it is a 13 millimeter bolt, so technically an 8 millimeter bolt. And cleaned everything up, jammed that in there, tightened it down, got it super tight. So we know that we're going to have a good body ground. Now later on, we're going to take care of some other issues ground related under the hood, but we'll get there when we get there. So right now, all the wiring is run for the front door speakers, the front dash speakers, and our ground is run for our amplifier. So we're going to move on and tidy up all this plastic, get that all put back together. Once we get all that put back together, then we can start mounting our amplifiers. The only problem with LED lighting is you get this crap. Another way to piss off the internet. So now we've got our two amplifiers mounted and the digital signal processor mounted. And unfortunately in this vehicle, we're kind of tied for space. Now there's a spot down underneath this area here where the spare tire would normally go. You can't see that. This area here where the spare tire would normally go. But the problem with that is that it gets a little damp under there. And I'm not putting the amplifiers there. And we're using a Class AB amplifier for the highs. Class ABs definitely need some good cooling because they produce a lot of heat. And this amplifier's got a couple of fans in it. And we want to make sure that we've got the heat sink available to open air so that it cools and doesn't overheat itself. So now that we have everything mounted where I want it mounted, I'm looking at it now and it appears as though the DSP is crooked, which is wonderful. So we'll have to fix that. We're going to mount everything. We got all the cabling ran. You guys can probably see some of that in over here. So we have the 1/0 cable, power and ground ran. We've got all the speaker lines and all of the speaker cables are marked as what they are. And we've got the 4 gauge for the JP34. We have the 0 gauge for the JP23. And then we're going to power the Zapco DSP off of one of those two, probably the 4 gauge, the same power that we're using to power the JP34. We'll power the DSP so we don't get any kind of weird ground looping or power looping or anything like that. So I'm going to go ahead and you can see we've got two fuse holders right there. So before you guys get on me about not having fuses, piss off the internet again, we will put fuses in it and probably hide those down in one of the cubbies or something so you don't have to see them. I don't really feel like mounting them anywhere because my goal is to be able to still bifold these seats. So the driver's side seat is bigger than the passenger side. The driver's side one is going to need to fold. The passenger side one is going to need to fold just in case I need to put anything in here. I can still do that. So I think that's what we're going to do, and that's how we're going. I'm going to straighten out that DSP, and I'm going to start wiring this thing. All right, so I went ahead and got a little bit crazy and finished the install without filming much of anything because it was just getting late and I was getting tired, but you can see they're installed nice to the seat. We've got the wiring done pretty decently. I mean, the seat has to move, so unfortunately a lot of that wiring has to move with it. The DSP over there, and so when you fold the seat up, the wires get a little funky and you just got to kind of tuck them back where they belong. Eventually I would love to put this in a different vehicle to where we had more space to work with, but the way the Jeep is now, I mean, you get the box right there and then the rear deck, and this whole section here is a false floor. I don't know how much you can see, but It's a false floor and it's got all these cubbies underneath it. And down in here, yeah, excuse that, that's a subwire. Down in here is the two fuse holders with the 200 amp for the big amp and the 100 amp for the smaller amplifier. They can kind of close all that stuff up. But we're limited on space. And for something this insane, well, not really insane, but for two amplifiers that are this long and this large, it's a little bit much. So we did go ahead and get that done. And then I'll show you guys one more thing. And we'll go over this in another video. But the wiring for the battery under the hood to the alternator, and then everything running back to the rear of the car, has all been upgraded, including all the grounds, all the powers, all that stuff. So we'll go over why I had to do that in a future video. But for now, that is all that we have done. And it sounds pretty good. We did some tuning on it and used the DSP in the laptop to get the tuning right. So we'll go over that in another video as well. And I'll show you guys how I did that and how to do that. But for right now, I think what we're going to do is end this video off here and move on to the next one. Okay, so I hope you guys enjoyed my foolproof way of angering the internet. It works every time. All you got to do is just be persistent. And eventually, somebody in your comments will lose their absolute mind over the fact that you spaced a zip tie a quarter of an inch too far when you were wiring up your amps. So again, all the stuff that I did here is subjective. Sound quality, subjective. Sound opinion, objective. Amp opinion, objective. It's all opinion. And truth be told, there are several different ways that you can go with this audio stuff. You can go super high-end and super expensive. You can go super low-end and super budget-friendly. And as long as you're doing things correctly and you're putting things where they're supposed to be, you're wiring it how it's supposed to be wired, and you're tuning it properly, you're going to have a halfway decent sounding stereo system. And now, mind you, in this vehicle, we did those two amplifiers with the two subwoofers. The rear door speakers are 100% stock. The front door speakers are just some Pioneer 6x9s. And the dash speakers are completely stock, and they play amazingly well. Now, this vehicle from the factory had the Boston Acoustic system in it, so those speakers are Boston Acoustic. Although they're not the best quality, they'll suffice for what we're trying to do here. And it sounds good. You know, I can definitely tell that there are some problems with the system in general. It's lacking in some areas, and there's some frequencies that are missing, and there's some scratchiness in the speakers. I can hear that. But somebody without a trained ear can't hear it, and it sounds amazing. So with that being said, I hope somebody in this video gets triggered and leaves me a crazy comment in the comment section, because that's always what I'm looking for. And we'll see you guys on the next one. I think we're going to go ahead and tune this thing and maybe set the gains. Ooh, yeah, we could do that video. We'll do that video next. We'll do video of setting the gains properly on your amplifier and your head unit so that things don't clip out and you don't blow speakers up. So I'll see you guys on that one. Have a good day.